am so proud to have you here for many, many reasons. One is to celebrate this book, which is a great book, a necessary book, and a book that I'm awfully glad that Todd and Matt co-authored. And I'm here to celebrate an earlier book by the co-founder of the Stimson Center, Dr. Bleckman, who took the first comprehensive cut at this set of issues in 1978 when he was at the Brookings Institution, before the Stimson Center was even a gleam in his eye. So, but really, top tier, top priority goes to nuclear weapons and coercive diplomacy. Our co-authors have updated Barry's work, in my view, in a pretty compelling way. Todd Sexer is an associate professor of politics at UVA, and his complete bio should be on your chair. Matthew Furman is a visiting associate professor at CSAC at Stanford, but his home base is Texas A&M. I have asked two folks who know a good deal about Asia to help us with some of the particulars, since most of the case studies of recent vintage have been there or may well be there. So my appreciation to Toby Dalton, the co-director of the nuclear program at the Carnegie Endowment, and Mira Rapp Uber, senior fellow at the Asia Pacific Security Program at the Center for New American Security, for joining us. And then Barry, I've asked to wrap it up. And Barry's going to have to leave a little bit early to make another appointment. So if you have questions to direct to him after everybody's given their presentations, please do so early on. So, Todd, it's all yours. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I I Gracias. best, I think, for the agency to be responsible for the outcome. I just keep an eye on the information that I find some of the things that are different between the services and the use of the tool and the other. So at the same time, India is the which is an interesting balance to some of this. India is exposed to the risk of the system, which to the extent that we must be able to deal with it, but still limited to the all of the effects of the nuclear weapon and the nuclear weapon and the nuclear weapon. So the nuclear is in the backdrop, and this takes a system that is very strong, but they also have a lot of, they're very capable of that system that is used, even if it's in the form of the sort of real effects of the form of the weapon. In other words, it's just really important. Let me just wrap up by saying that reading the conclusion of the paper, one of the top two points from the history of the paper. The first is that countries can turn the system to the financial sector to the government. The second is that the government is in the sector. The second is that the government is in the sector. I think this is a general problem. And that we have to actually sort of get rid of it. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about the
what? I also like to discuss a little bit about the decision to get into college in North Korea. I am not sure if you can get that from the chapter 3 of that document, but you can see what I'm going to do. In this chapter, our author is just to talk about how to study whether we feel like we're exposed to the greater component. They put the component not to us, but to the future to the future. And they don't talk to us about the future. We don't talk to us about the future, but the future is not to us. Thank you.
I'm contact with the nuclear institution. We did like that the relationship between the U.S. Soviet Union and the U.S. extension of the policy there has been surprisingly from the U.S. has greater success in the balance of the U.S. over the but in all probability, that was the result of those contextual factors. And there's a deep previous and mechanical balance of stress between those situations where it probably was certainly the biggest margin for the human origins of the relationship. Nuclear weapons deep down the balance of the human security is kind of not great in deterring the attacks on this country. We think we have some responsibility for our allies. I'm sure I'll say that we're very good at deterring some things in the past. In fact, the U.S. has been struggling with an example in which one of the countries has been working on the trailing rest of the allies and the U.S. And as you may even know, nuclear forces are not affected. They just keep losing. So, if these two things are correct, then the decisions on nuclear weapons should depend solely on our perception of the requirements as the deterrence. And I always say requirements in quotes because deterrence theory is not a scientific incident, something that is speculation about how decision making is not difficult to spend. So there could be many different views on I, for one, believe we can get by with a much smaller
number. Okay, I'm only going to ask one question. Other schools that the first one still believes the nuclear weapons offer fuels to the people. What is that PhD?
Well, that's
why do they come to such different conclusions?
Thank you. wanted to reinforce that idea about one of the great objectives of our book was to try to think of the role of nuclear weapons in a way that we felt that was respected by the one of the things that I think motivated the project was the use that these Cuban missile crisis could create an upside in the way that we think about nuclear weapons and nuclear weapons. And I'll go into scholarship about nuclear weapons, the Cuban missile crisis creating both economical both sides were concerned about accidental escalations in the region. And ultimately, the United States escalated the crisis around the dispute but when we look at the entire historical record of the Cuban crisis, it's not representative of nuclear conflict systems. It's too hard. It's the one case that we can find where it seems to be reasonable evidence, although there's continued evidence of structural capability, but there seems to be reasonable evidence that the good record is where it is in part of American history to occur. So I think stepping back from that single process and looking at the record gives us a different perspective. The Cuban missile crisis is in common with the structural and I'll say one other thing that another reflection from other scholars and people is that they usually often conflate the terms of humanity. Others, like the terms of humanity, are really two very different terms. That when we look at other academic studies that describe the value of the world of the weapons and humanity, when we look closely at the data, lots of cases have suggested that the world has been misinterpreted as cases of successful humanity. So we are more careful about how we analyze the data. I think this is really important to do, that coercion is definitely more
important than before. Three or four of the three studies will add and introduce yourself to the rest.
Thank you, Edward, if that's coming in the book. So a common question. The common is, the non-nuclear weapons states, particularly right now, are fond of saying it's a long history of the nuclear weapons states that failing the non-nuclear weapons states. To me, your work shows that, in fact, it's very difficult to find examples of that. And the other point is, when you're doing these case studies, how do you separate the nuclear component from conventional forces, economic influence, political influence? I guess in cases where coalition failed, you would say that all four of them failed. But your key point would be the nuclear component did not give the particular advantage. Maybe that's a symptom of the David Kissinger of UCLA. Very interesting discussion there. I wonder if the panelists could focus on the three contemporary policies in terms of the policies that they are with the terms of the first system. One being the make it more difficult for us to understand what's been prepared with the first thing to be a conceptual
investor. Yeah, and I'll say that in the next one more, just to show you first on the side.
Thank you. On the far left, perhaps, from your perspective. Pat Daly is my name. I'm with the Center for Global Solutions. I want to ask you all about another policy implication, another hypothetical future, which is a hypothetical future post-abolition world. Because those who are opposed to abolition, the breakout scenario is the single most often articulated objection. The world has abolished nuclear weapons, and somebody has managed to blow away a building, and then they whip back the curtain. And the claim is, country A, not nuclear armed, will say to country B, or multiple countries, all non-nuclear armed, you must do X or the atom bombs are coming. And they say, that's why we can't abolish nuclear weapons. But this seems to me a completely direct analogy between your definition of nuclear coercion. And I think at a minimum, your book says what you're claiming would happen in a post-abolition world has virtually never happened. That kind of coercion in a particular situation.
Well, I
a couple of questions to that, but very good. One question had to do with and whether the claim is true that the state has only been managed to and I mean, I would say that the evidence that we collect in this book suggests that we feel safe to say that. And going into the last question also, we have many cases of nuclear states
I'm going to go to the next slide. Well, you went out in the camp to make sure that there was something else. How do you see that?
Actually, I wanted to talk
in the bundle of a couple of questions or questions out there. So we're all going to be discussing in a second. Robert, I'll go to speak to you about the last one. I'm sure you can cover the body of things. You know, we talk about deterrence and talent in terms of the status quo of the time. But what we've seen in North Korea is effective effort to have the status quo time. So we do want to be in the conversation that happens. And so, and we recognize that in a way, so we can get it back. But anything like that is true for the future. And we can force a more important thing to do with it. Now that we have to look at this type of ability to solve that, it's not like we need to be able to deliver further than we need to be able to do with the technology that we can make. So, I think that I'm really interested in sort of maybe the next step, but I'd like to take it on.
Hi, Blaise. First, I wonder if you considered using a fictional example for your discussion with Job and threats and terrorism with Dr. King's life. A little bit more seriously, a lot depends on how you define your terms. But don't you think that North Korea, I'm not sure whether it was a successful, compelling threat or simply extortion, had managed to convinced the United States to give it lots of food aid several times in the past, just by the threat of developing nuclear weapons.
Thank you.
Thanks, Michael. I'm Peter Reed for the National Association. I want to go down the road that President Trump has been making in terms of the issue of extending that trend in that challenge. As you know, this issue is a thing of importance to the United States and its allies. What would you say the implications of the leadership and for this type of government specifically that might be more susceptible to coercive threats from the United States than the United States directly? And then second, how much does U.S. nuclear superiority or the importance of U.S. maintaining parity how important is superiority and parity for maintaining some independence in AI reassurance? Each of you, determined for us to correct the house, how important is the community for allies to be integrating the credibility of the U.S. Commitment to
security?
say two things about thinking about the implications of a work for nuclear weapons. The first has to do with the situation that I found life, the social application of several times the kind of proposed that in the future we might see nuclear powers using their nuclear weapons to compensate for the investment. That is something that the United States did not have to worry about that much, especially in the latter stages of the conflict. But if nuclear weapons do sort of hurt, peace to our states, it might seem to happen in the past. And the question is whether that would reverse the system. And I think the answer is probably not, for reasons that not just race. When states are using nuclear weapons, mostly maybe Russia, to compensate for past and the conventional capabilities, those gaps are being filled in the context of the conventional to compensate for the continued elements of ability to perform certain operational missions and operations of that is important. But aggression and coercion is different. Nuclear weapons don't do a good job of compensating for conventional weaknesses in the context of coercion. So I think even in the future, if countries attempt to use nuclear weapons to fill those gaps, they may succeed in doing so in the context of deterrence and defense, but not in the context of aggression. Secondly, I want to build off of a point that Toby made earlier in the discussion, which is that we have a tendency to open nuclear powers, historically, like I said, especially in crisis situations. And I think one of the conclusions of our work is that it's absolutely true, that it's easy to read a rough history of crisis between nuclear countries and read or infer that there was a lot of nuclear but when we look closely at these cases, it just turns out that these cases, even in the Cuban Missile Crisis, two participants on the U.S. side and the U.S. made the argument that nuclear powers are very near to nuclear weapons. When we reread the history of that crisis, we read nuclear weapons, not only in the way that the crisis played out, but also in the way. And I think that's actually the case for them. But I think our research is showing that we need to be cautious and not to overreact to the threat of nuclear weapons in the social crisis and also in the
future. I want to thank the authors of this book. I want to thank Mila and Toby for helping us sift through the arguments here. I think this book is an essential for most of the conversations we hear about nuclear weapons. But I also want you to leave this conversation with a question. And the question is, what could mess up this nuclear model? I'll give you a hint. The answer is in the book. And you have to buy the book to get the answer. So thanks, everybody.